That's Pastor Ray.
Good afternoon, all. Is that loud enough? Just want to make sure. There's been no name change or anything. It's just something to separate. There's about two or three other Ray Curtises out there in the ethers, and a couple of them are country musicians, and one of them is, I'm not quite sure what he does, but those videos are pretty lethal to look at, and I kind of wanted to do something to separate myself from what they do, so thus R. Allen Curtis. But everybody here knows the cuss called me Ray, or called me on time for dinner, whichever one it is. Whether we realize it or not, we're headed into a time that has happened in the past. This isn't something new. It may be new to us because we've not seen it in this context, but it's recorded history. Well recorded history. History that a lot of people tend to want to think, this isn't going to change anything. And they believe that because the history that they've seen is different than the history that was recorded in the Bible. And biblical history, as we all know, has been doubted. But no one will doubt the history that we didn't do it. Our government is writing a different history for us. Some will shout with glee, as we saw this morning, and saw people come in taking pictures of all of the signage and very happy and all of that. But we're going to find that all of that glee and calling of these times and saying that, oh wow, this country finally became fair. I know some people that would say, oh yeah, but we won't go there today. And other joyful phrases, but if you want to know the truth about it, our epitaph was just written by the Supreme Court this week. And when the period is dotted on that document, on that last phrase, the world will know why. If you really look at it, somebody sent me something a couple of nights ago, and they were showing all of the countries that have this law against the ones that don't. And it's a very fascinating division. Almost all of the quote-unquote communist countries still keep things as they are here. All of the countries of the West allow these marriages. This isn't me, this is just history, the writing itself. Writing the epitaph, setting up the lines of demarcation between the East and the West, if you will. Now, people are happy about it, and they think it's a good thing. Fairness has finally come to America, they say. I know some people that would question that, as I said, but many among us, on the other hand, look at this and say, wait a minute, when did we agree to this? Well, you kind of put it before the government, and you know what happens when you put things before the government. There's a tendency to do things the way they want to do it now. It's not like it used to be, of the people, by the people, for the people. Those days are over. It's of the corporation now. And whatever looks like it's going to be good for corporations, that's what's going to happen. Now, we were warned, as I said, as were the Israelites anciently, but they seldom listened. They allowed their leadership ultimately as led by the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes, to lead them away from God and into the arms of Rome's Caesars, whom they turned to when Yeshua came to them, but more about that later. You see, Lot was ridiculed, threatened, and ultimately ignored in Sodom. Then the fires came. But rather, maybe if they'd listened to him, the fires would not have come. But no, they couldn't do that. Noah was not mocked. He was basically ignored. A lot of people have read a lot of the little books and tracts where they talked about how Noah went up and down the countryside preaching and begging his people to repent. Well, yes, it took almost 100 years to build the boat, but believe me, it wasn't because he was going out preaching up and down the countryside. He was out there building. If people came up to him and asked, he told them what he was building it for, and it sounded a little odd because up to that point on the earth, there had been no rain. So, what are you building that thing for? And that's where most of the conversation centered, until the rains came. Many preachers try to say that Noah was mocked, but the Bible tells us plainly that the people were too caught up in their sins and lifestyles to worry about that big thing he's building over there for, what do they call it, rain? The few who asked what was going on obviously walked away in abject apathy. Notice the words of our Savior explaining what went on there for those who say that he was preaching up and down the countryside. It's quite the opposite of what happened. Let's drop anchor and hit Matthew, the 24th chapter, the 35th verse to get started. Matthew, the 24th chapter, the 35th verse, where it says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man." That's something you might want to listen to, considering that we're kind of slinking into those days. "For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day when Noah entered into the ark." Now, note that these civil actions of life were not criminal in themselves, but they had been taken away and they were removed in terms of the normal lifestyle, if you will. It is quite lawful to eat and to drink, provided it be in moderation and not to excess, and to marry and give in marriage when the laws, rules, and ends thereof are observed. I'm using my words very carefully here. "And therefore, this must be understood, either of their being wholly giving themselves up to the pleasures of life and the lusts of the flesh, without any concern about the affairs of faith, the affairs of worship, and the glory of God." In other words, the welfare of their physical souls. People tend to like to think that the soul is some ethereal, wafty thing. No, when the Bible talks about the soul, it's talking about the body. So they were not particularly worried about the welfare of their physical souls because they didn't realize that that's what you're going to have to take with you, at least when you go down, when you come back up. If you don't have that Holy Spirit within you, you've got nothing to ride there with. So because they were in such concern of their physical souls, they didn't realize they were approaching danger, of which Noah had given them warning. He had warned them of their luxury, their intemperance, their how they were eating. Not that they were eating, but let's understand how they were eating. They were libidinous in their eating habits. They ate, as they say, they ate as brute beasts. In other words, have you ever seen people eat after they've not eaten for maybe a day or two? And maybe don't have the best eating habits anyway. This is what they did daily. This is how they were. They indulged themselves in a brutish way. And also, they were libidinous in their, what's the word here? Unlawful marriages, in case anybody thinks that this is some new thing. For the word here used for eating signifies eating after the manner of brute beasts. They indulged themselves in a brutish way, in gluttony and drunkenness. So they drank the same way that they ate, as if there was no more coming, and they had to have it all. And it is certain from the account given of them biblically that they entered into unlawful marriages and unclean. I like the cute way he put this so that young America doesn't think we're up here talking dirty. He said that they were entered into unlawful marriages and unclean copulations. I say that so that no one has to explain to their children when they get home, but they get it completely. Wherefore, those things may be spoken of them as what were really sinful and wicked, thus they're being again so caught up in their lifestyle. Notice verse 39, if you kept your finger there. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. But we don't have to worry about that in the end times, because it's going to be nothing like that, right? No, let's read one more sentence. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. This we're seeing all around us. Man is not interested in the faith of God. The faith that man likes is about this world. Preaching on how to make it into the kingdom of God? No. Preaching on how to make money. How to survive in this sphere as it is, not trying to change it, not trying to make it better, trying to live more as if we were reading this book and not just sitting it in the back of the car and letting it collect dust. Teaching how to justify sin through the claims that the law is done away. Yet for all this bleeding that the law is done away, note the words of Yeshua, our Messiah. Matthew, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse. Matthew, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse, where it says, "Don't think that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I didn't come to destroy, but to fulfill. For most certainly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not even one smallest letter," he said, "not even the yod, or one tiny pin stroke, shall in any way pass away from the law until all things are accomplished." Now, look around. Is the earth still here? I'd say so. Therefore, the law is still there. Verse 19, "Whoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and teach others to do so, shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And please don't think that you being called the least or otherwise in the kingdom of heaven implies that you have to be there. Quick question for you. Are you there when you gossip or talk about each other on the phone? Are you there when somebody's out in the street talking about you? No. Being spoken of does not require your attendance or presence, does it? Don't forget that. But whoever, picking up at 19, whoever shall do and teach them shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, there's no way you will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, this in and of itself is a warning to the Pharisees and the scribes, but they didn't heed it either. Man never truly reads or heeds the word of God as it is written until they feel a little heat coming up on the back side a little bit. And then they might make some temporary changes until the heat subsides. You see, for years, the world's churches have gone along with the world and the government to get along. And when it intervened in the rule of the church, man has always found a way to declare in some way that God's law is null and void or done away. Yet, there's a warning given for the lawless by Paul. Let's go to Romans, the 6th chapter, the 17th verse. Romans, the 6th chapter, the 17th verse, where it says, by God's grace, you were once slaves to sin, obeyed from your heart. Obeyed from your heart the pattern of teaching to which you were exposed. And after you had been set free from sin, notice how slyly Paul implies that what we learned from Yeshua, even the later Judaism that he left behind after being blinded for 3 days on the road to Damascus, Syria. Amazing how these same places keep popping up in history. You know, they always talked about Damascus, but they never told you that it was in Syria. And also, you had been set free from sin. You became enslaved to righteousness. I am using popular language because your human nature is so weak, Paul says. For just as you used to offer your various parts as slaves to impurity and lawlessness, which led to more lawlessness, so now offer your various parts as slaves to righteousness, which leads to being made holy, set apart for God. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in relationship to righteousness. But what benefit did you derive from the things of which you are now ashamed? In other words, when you changed, why are you hanging on to the old stuff? What did you get from it? There was nothing to win. The end result of these things was death. However, now freed from sin and enslaved to God, you do get the benefit. It consists in being made holy, set apart for God, and its end result is eternal life. For what one earns from sin is death, but eternal life is what one receives as a free gift from God. In union with the Messiah, Yeshua, our Master. This is what is lacking in the world's belief systems. They either dismiss the word of God altogether to be accepted by the world, or they defang the word and justify sin by declaring that there is no law. Thus, with no law, there is no sin. If there's no sin, there's no need for repentance. That's why the teaching of it is so weak in the churches. Because many accept this rot. But that's exactly what it is. It's rot. Rotten to the core. And the continued belief in it corrupts many. Yet others believe in the law, but continue in that belief to repeat the same sins, going back again and again and again, expecting that God will allow it again and again and again, and repent again and again and again, and they expect that he will let it go again and again and again for the same sin. Yet, there's a danger in this. We all know how deceptive our hearts are. Yet, so does God Almighty. He knows that sometimes we don't intend to sin again, but it just kind of happens. We recognize that, and I'm sure he recognizes that. But there's a little marginal line where you finally decide, you know what, I can do this just one more time. And you go in with the intention of doing that one more time, and the next thing you know, you're caught up in it. There's a point at which this is no longer repentance, even if you continue to repent after you do it. I don't know where the line is because I didn't draw it. But only God knows where that line is. It's not my place to draw it. But it is where our problem begins today. This was done by married men in Israel. It was upheld by the Pharisees. We do it today as well, but God is not mocked. I don't care how much you change the law. God knows what his natural law is. You see, God is not mocked. We must decide what will save us. And our title today is Erasure or Forgiveness. Erasure or Forgiveness. Don't get confused with that movie Erasure. We're not talking about that. What I'm talking about erasure is where you... How many of you have been in a classroom in your lifetime? Remember how the teacher would get up there and write something, and then after that she would erase it, and after about a week she would write something and erase it, maybe the cleanup crew didn't come in that weekend, and so she came in Monday and it was still there, all that dust, and she wrote in there, and sometimes at the back of the class, you couldn't see it. Think of that like sin. Every time you repent, it's just erased. But the residue of it is still there. And there, and there, and there. And the more is written up there, the more dust and residue is there, until at the end of the week, finally, after 2 weeks, the janitor comes in, and it's not enough to just erase it. He's got to get some soap and water, or in our case, blood. Then he has to clean it with that soap and water. And then you can start to write something new. And maybe the people at the back of the class can see it better. When Christ comes before the Father in that Holy of Holies, in that Holy of Holies in heaven, when we repent, he erases with his own blood, but he's not going to keep doing that. At some point in his place, not mine, I can't tell you where it's going to be. He's done that 1,000 times. He intends to do it again. We can't do this anymore, but it's not our place to say when that is. It's God's place, and it's ours to make the decision, I've got to stop doing that, whatever that is. You see, there's a danger in this. We all know how deceptive, as I said, our hearts are. But for our purposes today, We'll just call this repeating of sins and empty requests for forgiveness the process, as I said, of erasure. We believe our sins have been forgiven, but we continue to commit the same sin over and over again. So apparently, from the looks of this, it was done by biblical people as well. This isn't something new. Like I said earlier, hey, over the last 6,000 years, same physiology, same psychology. But I want you to notice what happens when people get in charge that recognize their flaws. Apparently in the Bible this was done as well, but the Levitical laws were twisted, allowing a certain amount of sin to slip through where men and marriage were concerned. From again the days of Noah, adultery has been a problem within marriage and was probably one before that. That fact alone illuminates the reason why the Bible repeatedly tells us to flee from sexual sins. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, the 15th verse. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, the 15th verse, where it says, "Surely you know that your bodies are part of Christ himself. So I must never take what part is of Christ and join it to a prostitute." The scriptures say the two people will become one. Don't have to get graphic, it's pretty obvious what he's talking about here. So you should know that anyone who is joined with a prostitute becomes one with her in body. But anyone who is joined with the Lord is one with him in spirit. So run away or flee from sexual sin. It involves the body in a way that no other sin does. So if we commit sexual sin, you are sinning against your own body. You should know that your body is a temple for the Holy Spirit, that you receive from God and that lives in you. You don't own yourselves. God paid a very high price to make you his own blood. So honor God with your body. This is also why God so detests adultery. God sees it in the same light as he does, having other gods before him. As far as he's concerned, it's the same thing. It seems the spiritual aspect of marriage is seldom seen in its full glory by mankind. That blindness may be, not giving anybody excuses, just saying, that blindness may be the reason for the Supreme Court's recent blunder. And believe me, in the end, it will prove to be a blunder. As did the Pharisees' dalliance with the government of Rome and the Caesars. It gave them, for a time, a power that seemed to go to their heads. You see, once Yeshua came onto the scene, and some of the people of Judea began to listen to him and perhaps believe him and think, hey, maybe this is our Messiah. The Pharisees, the scribes, and ultimately the high priest decided he's got to go. You see, initially in the eyes of the people, this was a difficulty. For the Pharisees, it was even more of a difficulty because how do we get rid of this guy? And they found this difficult. You see, this was not the ordinary type claim Messiah that came along. This one was real. And somehow they knew it. But did it change their mind in terms of how to deal with him? No. He was simply beyond their ability to gainsay his wisdom. Now it gets interesting. So we see how all this comes together. Let's go to John, the 8th chapter, the first verse. Amazing how this just happens week after week after week. Yeah, Thurman got bit this week. Love it. Love it. John, the 8th chapter, the first verse, where it says, "Then Yeshua went to the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple. And all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman taken in adultery. And standing her in the midst, they said to him, 'Teacher, this woman was taken in adultery, in the very act.' Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. You then, what do you say?" They said this, tempting him so that they might have reason to accuse him. You know that there was an ulterior motive. With the Pharisees toward Yeshua, there was always an ulterior motive. Now, keep your fingers here, or if you've got electronic things, keep your stylus here. We'll get back to it. Before we go any further, let us first note the Levitical ruling on adultery. Any crime, for that matter. You see, it says it must be witnessed by two persons at least who could be witnesses of it. Otherwise, the accusation was not legal. Note further the actual law on this crime, just to make it sure that we understand that this is biblical. Leviticus, the 20th chapter, the 10th verse. Leviticus, the 20th chapter, the 10th verse, where it says, "And a man who commits adultery with a man's wife, who commits adultery with his neighbor's wife," don't miss this, "the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death." Need another witness? Deuteronomy, the 22nd chapter, the 22nd verse. Deuteronomy, the 22nd chapter, the 22nd verse, where it says, "If a man is found lying with a woman married to a husband, then they shall both of them die. The man that lay with the woman and the woman. So you shall put away evil from Israel." But as usual, the Pharisees were looking to trap Yeshua, but with corrupted laws. The contrast with corrupted Judaism is quite evident. You see, in the law given to Moses, as seen earlier, if a man or a woman were brought to a judge, both the man and the woman were to be brought to the judge, and both were to be put to death. However, over the years, the Hebrew attitude toward adultery changed over the years. They kept the ancient world's traditional definition of adultery as a sexual relationship between a married woman and a man who was not her husband. But their response to it, see if this sounds familiar to you modern 21st century enlightened folk, it evolved. Whenever that word evolved comes up, get a little nervous. Their process evolved as succeeding generations sought to reconcile competing moral values. I thought there were moral values and those which were not moral. I didn't know that they were in competition. That's in the mind of man, not in the mind of God. But they succeeded to in the coming generations to reconcile competing moral values. In the Assyrian and in the Babylonian codes, a husband had the option of saving the life of his wife, as long as he saved the life of her paramour as well. But this choice did not exist in Hebrew law. Soon after it was put into writing, the death penalty for adultery, and it seems to over time have disappeared and been replaced with compulsory divorce. In other words, the marriage was dissolved with or without the consent of the husband by the priests, and if the man wanted, the man could divorce a woman for virtually any reason he wanted. Or if he just wanted to. If he saw someone that looked a little better, he could just say, I don't want you anymore, and could leave. But for women, this was nearly impossible. There was no law by which she could initiate the divorce. That's why years later, feminism became so interesting when it started to, quote unquote, remedy some of these unfair practices, which they were unfair practices, but the remedy turned out to be worse than the disease. The decision was that all of a sudden, over time, what was law suddenly became opinion, and it got very waffly in the details. He surely had to be understanding that something was wrong here. For sure, Yeshua knew. He knew their hearts. He knew their minds. He knew what was going on with them. But in the new laws, the marriage was dissolved for just about anything, always by the man. But you see, Yeshua surely was aware by then what was going on, especially when they only brought the woman forward. Who was she there with? What were they doing? You see, the question comes quick to mind, well, hey, what happened here? Surely he knew that there was a paramour. He had to know. So the question quickly comes to my mind, you know how I think, where was the man? And more importantly, who was the man? But let's notice how this is resolved by Yeshua. Go back to chapter 8 and we'll continue at verse 6. They said this, tempting him so that they might have reason to accuse him. But bending down, Yeshua wrote on the ground with his finger, appearing as if he didn't hear them. Now, it's worth mentioning here, in answering an earlier question, that these sworn upholders of fair and balanced justice, if you will, did not bring the adulterer as well as the adulteress to this proceeding. Had their designs in coming to Yeshua been purely from regard to the sanctity of God's law, they would have been equally anxious to punish the man as they were to punish the woman. For so the law enjoined or said, hey, this is what we do. The true law, not the law of the time, if you will. Not what was currently acting as law under Pharisaical rule. You see, as said before, it had become more male dominated and sexist and was not exactly fair to women or, in the long term, families. Sometimes you become so selfish you don't realize what you're doing for the succeeding generations in your selfishness. And when those results begin to come to the fore, you want to walk away and say, oh, I didn't have anything to do with that. Oh, but you did. Families were destroyed in this. Yeshua, keenly aware of this change, challenged it in his sly way, as the Pharisees continued to rail at him to do something. Verse 7. But as they continued to ask him, he lifted himself up and said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone at him." And again, bending down, he wrote on the ground. Now, much speculation has been made over the years as to what he wrote on the ground, as Thurman asked earlier. And it has been said that in an ancient Greek manuscript, it was found that Yeshua wrote some of the leading sins of the scribes and some of the leading sins of the Pharisees, and possibly even something I've said before but have rejected, the high priest. No one knows, because no one has found these Greek manuscripts and presented them as proof. But of course, as God, Christ surely knew. But this is mere conjecture. But as the Holy Spirit here is silent on the subject, I think it becomes us to be the same. Verse 9. And hearing and being convicted by conscience, they went out one by one. That tells you enough right there. If they were convicted by conscience, something he wrote surely put a little heat behind somebody to make a move and walk away. Just something to think about. They went out one by one, beginning, fascinating, at the oldest until the last. And Yeshua was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. And bending back up and seeing no one with the woman, Yeshua said to her, "Woman, where are the ones who accused you? Did not one give judgment against you?" And she said, No one, Lord. And Yeshua said to her, "Neither do I give judgment. Go and sin no more." Now that is forgiveness as opposed to erasure. For you can be sure that having escaped sure punishment and shame, she surely didn't go back out there to have another woman's husband. This is where all must end up at this point. We have to get to that point where we recognize surely that our sins will find us out. Therefore, maybe it's time to stop committing them over and over again, thinking, "Oh, I've got a problem in that area." Yeah, you got a problem in that area. It means you keep doing it. And I'm not talking about addictions, although everything now is an addiction. So, you know, I'm addicted to air. Yeah, I'm addicted to air. If I stop breathing, guess what? I'll just die. And some people feel that way about other things that have nothing to do with your living process. I like her. And if I don't have her, I'm gonna, yeah, right. This is how we get. I'm not talking about anybody, I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. And at some point in my life, I was talking about me too. We've all been there. We've all been there. But we have to reach that point where once we know that we've got a problem, work a little harder on that problem. Because we don't know where that line is where God says he's not working on it anymore. Then he knows your heart. We don't. So we just see you doing the same thing over and over again. To us, it's just so-and-so. Leave him alone. He'll fall eventually. And you get to a point where you almost, as you watch the person rise, you feel like, why doesn't God strike him down? We don't know where he is in connection to this lie. We don't know how hard he or she is trying to get rid of their problem, whatever that problem is. I'm not going to name anything because I don't want anybody, oh, you're talking about me. No, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about what I'm talking about. And I happen to be talking about something that you may be doing. So deal with it. We have to get to that point where we recognize that if you've got a problem, you can't just say, no, I'm just going to repent of it again. Like we do about our laws. And well, we'll just get rid of the law. We'll just change the law. Then everybody can do it. In this case, marriage. But we're not talking about that. We'll just go back to what we're talking about. Now, much, as I said, speculation has been made here about a lot of these things. But we have to get to that point where we know the difference between forgiveness and erasure. Forgiveness gets rid of the sin. Erasure just makes it so no one can see it clearly. But God sees it clearly. Please don't forget that. God knows our hearts. He knows them intimately. He built them. He constructed it. He constructed all of this. He knows what's expected of us. But he also knows what's really going on in there. I'm not going to sit here and try to guess, and I suggest we not do the same. Because any sins found on our record, unrepented of, at the ends of our lives, will be held against us. Notice, James, the 4th chapter, 17th verse. Almost done. James, the 4th chapter, the 17th verse, where it says, therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. 2 Peter, the 2nd chapter, the 20th verse. For if we... For if they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the full knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Yeshua Messiah, and are again entangled, they have been overcome by these, their last things are worse than their first. For it would have been better for them not to have fully known the way of righteousness than fully knowing it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. If the commandments are done away, why is Peter talking about the commandments? Because they're still in force. 22. But the word of the true proverb has happened to them. The dog turning to his own vomit, and the washed sow to wallowing in the mire. And then it gets interesting because people ask, well, how do we know? I said, go to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, the 26th verse. It lays it out a little bit better. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, the 26th verse. The operative word here, willfully. For if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins. In other words, no more blood for the blackboard. It's written up there. You might erase it, but the residue is still there. And now there's no blood to wash it away. There remains no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversary. Those who despised Moses' law died without mercy on the word of two or three witnesses. Of how much more punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy of punishment, the one who has trampled the Son of God? who has counted the blood of the covenant with which he was sanctified an unholy thing, and has insulted the Spirit of grace. For we know him who has said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. I can hear it now, somebody.
Don't judge me.
Yeah, please say that to God.
And I
won't say that. 31. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. You see, the majority of this world's believers are in a quandary about the truth of God. Don't entirely blame them. If you sit in a church for years and they teach you that the law is done away and that you don't have to keep the law, what are you going to do when you walk out there in the streets? Break that which does not exist. Therefore, what have you broken? In your mind, nothing. Just think about it. Don't be too judgmental, because when they come back to realize that, oops, who can they come to if we've got our backs turned? Just something to think about. But you see, the majority, as I said, of the world's believers have been taught something different for so long and in such a cavalier fashion that they believe it without question, because it allows them to do what they want to do in the world, say what they want to say in the world, have what they want to have in the world, be what they want to be in the world. What brings us to Caitlyn Jenner, brings to the Supreme Court decision, most of the music on the air, let's sit down and listen to it. It's all sex. They call it love, but it's not. It's just sex. Stall it is 90% of what you hear. If you really go back and listen to the words, I could do a whole thing on hours of that. I've listened to it for years, played it for a while. If you listen to most of what's on the radio, it's about sex, not love. No matter how great the strings are, all so drippy and syrupy and sound so good and arranged so well, but it's still just sex, which is fornication. It's time we learn the truth. We can't continue to pretend that we don't know. We can't keep acting as if we don't know. We've had warning after warning after warning. Let's go through a few just in case we forgot. We had 9-1-1. 200-story towers came falling down into their foundations, and no one knows what happened. I mean, I can tell you what happened today. It would take another hour and a half. We don't have it. But that was a warning of sorts. Then we had Katrina, hurricane of immense proportions. How many of you have seen a report about New Orleans in the last, year or two? Think it's all fixed? Huh? No. Not yet. Probably won't be. We've had other droughts, tornadoes, super tornadoes. You ever seen a super tornado? I'd never heard of these until the last year or two, where a cloud comes up and you've got four or five of them in a row. Where they used to drop and bounce, now they just go across the land, tearing up everything like a hurricane. Never seen that before. Now all of a sudden it's happening over the last few years. That was a warning. We don't see it that way, but it was a warning. We have oil in the Atlantic from the BP oil spill a few years ago. Thought that was cleaned up, huh? Oh, please, come back to the coast. We're all cleaned up and everything looks so beautiful. Yeah, then what are those ducks doing walking around in oil? Nothing has been changed. Nothing has been cleaned up. They just pushed it down to the bottom. They'll go swim down a little bit deeper and you come up oily and not knowing what happened, because they just poured this stuff on the oil that made it sink to the bottom. It's still there, and it's still killing everything in the Atlantic, slowly. Just had a new spill, was it yesterday, in Santa Barbara. As if it isn't bad enough with all of the radiation that's already out there coming from the Fukushima reactor in Japan. That's a warning of sorts, I'd say. And then, biblically, over the last 2 years, we've got one more coming, we've had 2 years of high day blood moons, a lot of the ministers who said that we knew what that was all about, they're telling stuff that has nothing to do with it. So most people have no idea that that's not so much a warning, but to let you know, I'm still here. These are the days we're expected to keep. They were red flagged for you, but it meant nothing because most of us, because it was so early in the morning, didn't know whether it ever happened or not. But I wonder, what will it take to wake this world up? What will it take? Let us not worry about that right now. Let's just keep our eyes open. Because God, in his time, will find a way to wake us up. There's one way. How many of you lived in California at any time? How many of you have ever experienced an earthquake? Fun, huh? No. Not fun. Every fault in this country has gapped open in the last 3 weeks. San Andreas, which goes all through from California all the way downstate to Illinois. The New Madrid, that starts downstate, works all the way up to Lake Michigan and further up back. All of that has gapped open over the last month. And a whole lot more. You'll never hear about it in the news. They just say something. They don't tell you anything about the implications of this and how much of it is caused by fracking of oil or any of that. All warnings, little things to let you know things are not as they should be. But basically, all we can do is what we've been doing, just a better job of it. Pray. Live our lives according to the will of God, not the whims of man. And if we sin, repent of it and do our level best to never commit that sin again so that that blood does cover it. Let God forgive it. Not the lawlessness of man or his priests or his bishops or his popes or his president or whoever. You see, no one else can erase your sin by declaring the law null and void. Because the law is not null and void. But the lawbreakers, if they're not careful, soon will be. Let us remember, we're interested in forgiveness, not erasure. God bless you all.